Hello, this is part two of a series of video on independent component analysis applied to EEG time series. This is the second part, how does Infomax ICA work? And this video is not so technically challenging here. I'm just going to give you some intuition of how ICA works, not delve into the mathematics. And so here is a comparison between PC and ICA. So on here we have PCA. So if we have two variables, variable one, variable two, that could be electrode one, electrode two, for example. And then here each of the dots on the diagram could be some time points. They are not linked by time here, but we can imagine this would be time one, time two, time three, time four, etc. And then what PCA is going to find is going to find the axis along which the projection of the data on this axis has maximum variance. So the first axis is going to be along this direction, and the second axis is going to be perpendicular to the first axis. ICA, by contrast, is going to find the projection of the data points that maximize independence. So it's going to find the axis along which the data is maximally independent. So ICA is a method that tends to recover the original sources. Here we can imagine that there's two processes that influence the data, one along this direction and one along this direction. And by multiplying by the unmixing matrix, we can recover the activity of these sources. So while PCA simply decorrelates the output, ICA attempts to make the output as statistically independent as possible while placing no constraints on the orthogonality of the matrix. Here is how ICA, in particular Infomax ICA, works. So if we have some time series, some EEG time series here, so this is the time series, and we can imagine this is a brain source. So this would be putting an electrode inside the brain and being able to record the activity of that source across time. What we can do with this source is we can artificially put a grid on it and count the number of values in each of these rows here and build an histogram. So this is the histogram of values. And if we have a smooth version with very small bin, this is called the probability density distribution. So that's for a first source. Now imagine we have a second electrode for a second source. But what we record on the scalp is really a mixture of these two sources, assuming there's no other source active in the brain. And so we record first scalp channel and a second scalp channel. So the scalp channel are, by definition, a mixture of source A and source B. And in this case, for electroencephalography, to the best approximation, this is a linear mixture. So this is perfectly adapted for ICA. And what the central limit theorem tells us is that the mixture of this source, if you take an infinite number of this source, A, B, C, D, etc., and these are independent of each other, the mixture is going to converge to a Gaussian distribution. So what we can do, what ICA can do, is that it starts from the scalp channels and then it's going to rotate it's going to rotate axis in multi-dimensional space, so has to make the projection as non-Gaussian as possible in order to recover the sources. So this is better illustrated in this diagram here, where we start, this is not very realistic for EEG sources, but here we start, we have two axes, two variables, and the first step is to normalize on each axis. So that's a process that's called whitening. And this is the projection of the data on the two axes. This is the axis for the data. And then what ICA is going to do is going to rotate this axis, so has to make the projection on this axis as independent as possible. And to rotate the axis, what it's going to do is going to maximize the entropy. So why maximize the entropy? So this is a calculation of the entropy. So this is, for example, a dice. So the dice can take a value 1 to 6, and it's uniform. The priority of each face is 1 over 6. Use Shannon formula for calculating entropy, and that gives you an entropy of 2.58. Now imagine you have a fake dice that makes a 6 half the time. then it's less uniform and the entropy is going to be lower. So the more uniform, the more random, and the higher the entropy. So that's what we're going to try to maximize in that case. And we're not going to simply maximize the entropy along each axis. We're also going to maximize the joint entropy, because the joint entropy is related to meteorite formation, as you'll see in a few minutes. So so that's Shannon formula, how the joint entropy is the entropy of the first process, the entropy of the second process, minus the meteorite formation between the two. And we'll see what is important. So how do we calculate the joint entropy? Well, it's very similar to calculating the entropy. So for instance, if we have a table, here these are behavioral measures. It's just asking people how stressed they are and how many emotional events they had in a given day. And then we can see this contingency table where we had 19 people in this cell, 4 people in this cell, 63 people in this cell, etc. What we can do is that we can calculate the probability for each of these cells as it is represented here. And then we use Shannon definition of joint entropy to calculate the sum of probability times the log of the probability of each cell to get a specific number. So how can we relate this to ICA? So what about the ICA learning rule? How to make outputs statistically independent? Well, the goal can be to minimize their redundancy or mutual information. So how do we do that? Well, if we look at the formula we had before, where the joint entropy is equal to the entropy of the first output plus the entropy of the second output minus the mutual information, really, if we want to minimize the mutual information, we can maximize the entropy. And that's exactly how Infomax ICA works. So, and the mutual information is zero if the two variables are independent. So the learning rule is to change the weight matrix, so to change the rotation, the axis, in order to maximize the entropy and find an entropy extremum. And then there is another term in the Infomax learning rule, which is called the natural gradient of MRE, and that's a rescaling factor that helps the weight matrix to converge faster. So this was just to give you an intuition of how ICA works. In the next videos, we'll see how it can be applied to EEG data.